Sani Bonani, welcome back to another episode of Hot Tea Thursdays. Ngumama Zizwe, and I'm here to fill your hearts with art. In this podcast, we talk about art. We talk to the people that make the art, the people behind the people that make the art, and the people that make the art, but a lot of people don't know that they do. And today we have a distinguished guest whose creative footprint spans theater, film, and fashion. Mr. Jefferson J. Bobs Tshabalala. He is a founder and the first ever person to give me a chance when I started my creative journey. Thank you so much for honoring my invitation. Welcome to Hot Tea Thursdays. Thank you. Please tell us about yourself, your background, how your creative journey started, and the difference between J-Box or J-Bobo and
Jefferson. My name is Jefferson Tshabalala, from the Eastern Cape. I'm the maker of the pot. That's what I try to tell myself every morning before I attack the world. I just make the things that need to be done. I'm an artist, I'm an entrepreneur, and I'm a teacher. And how that manifests is in the spheres that you've spoken about. But like at my core, man, I'm just a storyteller with a particular interest in histories of abantu abamnyama. And that's really what keeps me going, telling Black people stories as authentically as I possibly can.
That's amazing. And who is J-Bobs, J-Boboza?
Yeah, so like, I think one of my biggest forays into performance was always about so many of my favorite actors are always typecast once they've done one role. So many of my favorite performers, I've seen them like the moment they play the executive and they do it well, they are the executive for the next 30 years. When they play the gangster, they are the gangster for the next 30 years. And when we were creating sketches and comedy shows, like, we thought of coming up with characters that we would play, that we would invent ourselves, that could span across like a myriad of characters, right? So like, we made like these camp archetype, like Jay Boo Boo, like very flamboyant lipstick, makeup, and all of that. And then we have like this like kind of Gussie-esque, roughish Jay Boza thing going on. Then we have this fake American Turing Jay Boza thing going on. So like, the idea with creating those characters was just saying that the Black experience is so vast. Black actors are so talented. They can do so much with their bodies, with their voices, with accent, with just like physicality, that even though they all might have the same initials because it's the same actor, they can like sound different, look different, come from a different perspective altogether. So that's where that predominantly comes from. But Bobs is in my ID. and that's usually what I go by when I'm directing work. And then like when I'm doing like rap parody work, it's like J-Boboza. When I'm doing like performativity of like the flamboyant people that I grew up watching in the Eastern Cape, I do J-Boo-Boo things. When it's like the boys I grew up around, it's like J-Boza things. Yeah, so like, that's just like for myself as a performer to stay fit and agile.
Yeah, and I think that's very important because like, even the stories end up just being the same. Like, you end up watching different shows, but it's actually the same storyline, exactly. the same everything. And so now you ventured into film and the film on the fashion space with Updop Shishin.
Mm-hmm.
So could you please share more about the creative vision behind Updop Designs and mm-hmm. Lasin Park Shishin?
So one of the things, like when we say like, storytelling with a particular focus on like Black people, with a particular focus on Black township people, you find that there's kind of a uniform gaze in terms of like ikasi linje, you know, and sometimes people don't have a long width and breadth of, you know, and they vary like across like a very huge spectrum. So, like, what does, like, if we go to popular media and we go, who's your favorite Gussie nerd? People take a while. Yeah. The moment you say, who's your favorite Gussie thug? People can list, you know, who's your favorite promiscuous girl? It's quick to find the promiscuous girl. Who's the slay queen? It's quick to find. So, with Dope Dope Designs, also about going, like, what's the Gussie story that's on the margin but has been marginalized. Because sometimes what happens is that a thing is made to look like it's not there by being ignored. And then we end up thinking ayiko, but everybody knows a buff. Everybody knows like a nerd. Everybody in a hood knows, oh, lama technology. Or here's that person who likes this kind of books. Or here's that guy with an esoteric interest in this kind of music that people don't say black people listen to. And for us, it's about like excavating those people and those stories. So that's where things like board games come into play. Like, what are the contributions of black and brown people that are not on the so-called mainstream? And because we have like some inroads into the mainstream to make those stories come out. So if we're going to make a play, our lead, like if we'd make a play like Ekaslam, for instance, our lead is someone who's interested in poetry, who's also interested in teaching, who thinks Kwaito can be taught in curricula. That's the kind of person we feel like, that's the person who should get 90 minutes on stage so that black people can see another version of what is possible to be umdwaselokshini.
And so how do these ventures reflect your evolving creative interests, and what impacts do you hope to make in the film and the fashion space, like in the long run?
So when I used to work like in wardrobe, because I think everyone in South Africa who's in the creative field has worked in every department at some point or other. So I've worked in wardrobe for like theater productions or stage plays. And I saw, man, like the assumption of like what black people wear is like so far-fetched. Like I'm like, where do these people imagine? But where are these black people? How come I don't know them? Like, why are you dressing me in these things that I don't understand? And I realized that like for the longest time, like art directors, costume designers are people who are so out of touch with what like the urban black lived experience is. You know, like they're still watching reference videos from like the 80s and the 90s, and they're still dressing people in that way. And with the work that we do in the fashion space, it's like, it's direct research asking black people, what do you like? Or how do you want to be seen? Or like, what's nostalgia to you? Like, what does fabric quality mean to you? What's durable? What makes you feel like, yeah, I'm a working professional, or I'm casual, or I'm at leisure? So with our designs at like Sinpa, we try to do that. We try to capture a kind of elevated costume for upwardly mobile black people. Yeah, man, like I am in a uniform of ubuhle, you know. It's beyond where my geography is. That's why it's Sinpa. I can be Sinpa anywhere in the world as myself, you know, as a version of myself that I identify. And like to be a Bantula is not to be rugged only, is not to be low life only. I can be in my delela and my button up shirt and my tie. I can wear my delela and my three faith. I can wear my delela and my slippers. I can wear it without a shirt. So like the various levels of expression can come however. And that's what I'm hoping the footprint will be, that like whether it's through the art we make or whether it's through the apparel that we make, that people will always recognize themselves as great wherever they are.
Wear the art, yeah. And you rock your delela and you be seen part all over the world. So your directional debut, Exit Exhibition and Transit, it kicked off a series of thought-provoking productions after that.
Yeah.
How do you choose or conceptualize your themes for plays?
That's interesting for me because Ukbala for me is almost like collaborative, and collaborative with my audience. So I'm always informed by the audience, but I also take the responsibility of leading my audience. So like I always try to, I'm of the belief that the artist must know a great deal more about the layer of the land, but then they will be taught about how that thing sits by the audience. So the audience is in the lead when it comes to reception. And they're in the lead when it comes to palette. But you must always be in the lead when it comes to making. You can't be told by the audience what to make, or else you're pandering. You're not making art. You need to have things of charge, things that you're really passionate about, things that you want to challenge. And the only way you can get glow level is if you're curious.
Mm.
So if you're curious about certain things, if you're curious of, like, because I'm always trying to answer a question with every project, or I'm always trying to explore a realm with every project. So if I go, hey man, you know, I've been to so many parties, I've been so many casual engagements, and whenever we're chilling and it's time for like people to play, they want to pull out 30 seconds. I love 30 seconds. I'm good at it. I play nicely. People want to pull out Monopoly. I love it. Want to pull out Scrabble. I love it. Hey man, all these people that are around me are like interesting artists, black professionals, like amazing people in like in philanthropy, all these spaces, and they know so much about the world. Mm-hmm. But the knowledge that they know about themselves is nowhere in any of this recreation. So if I then go, okay, I'm going to create a thing where next time these people feel like playing, they can play with their own knowledge and their own knowledge system. That question might take me a couple of years to answer. So then I go, oh, okay, we're going to make this township knowledge trivia show. It's going to be a TV show. No, it's going to be a theater show. No, it's going to be a board game. No, it's going to... So to iterate and go, that's how I answer the question of what I feel is not there. Because then I must be able to... And if like the first thing that I do next week is go, hey everybody, welcome to Hati Thursdays. I've done what she's already doing. So like I'm duplicating a thing that already exists and that I'm not advancing the conversation any further. So I must feel as though as the maker of things, I am making a thing whereby once I've made it, there's a new conversation to be had. No one can say anymore that, no, we only have, you must choose 30 seconds, but not because LLL is not there. You must have the option. And that's what I like to make. I like to make things where I go, this option wasn't there before, now it's there.
And how has that journey been like since from the beginning stages of the board game to where it is now?
Yo, that has been such an incredible journey. Hey? And incredible also in ways of ipolitiki, because when you enter anything where retail is involved, you start to see why this thing didn't exist before. Because you think, oh, I've got this idea, how come no one has ever thought? No, then you realize the level of gatekeeping, the level of red tape. When you write to these retailers to say, hey, can you take a couple of these on consignment? Or can we bring 50 units to you? No, you must first go through, and you realize, oh, wait a minute, this is like a cornered market. There are a couple of people playing to ensure that that market remains as small as it is, and playing to make sure that the price points to produce remain as high as they are, and further alienating people from entering the playing field, you know, so that we can all of us must own a taxi, all of us must open a tavern, and you know, like,
yeah,
there's particular businesses that are meant for people like us, you know. So for me, it feels like doing something like this has shown me, oh, this is what years of patience looks like. Oh, this is what making multiple versions looks like. This is what trying to find the ideal contract with collaborators looks like. And it's like an ongoing process. But yaqala nobona ubana abantu bayachafa, abantu bayadinwa very quickly. And it's understandable because we have urgent needs.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes some ideas don't make it, not because they are bad or like poorly executed, but because the driving forces behind them got tired along the way. Mm.
Wow. And okay, so how does directing for award ceremonies differ from directing a theatrical production? So I've seen that you've been part of like some award ceremonies, like the South African Hip Hop Music Awards, and so how is that different from actually directing a theater piece?
Well, that's interesting because, yeah, if I go back to Lando Benitata Kalinobana, across the board, I'm storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to find the best way to tell the story at all times. So sometimes you find that like the medium of the storytelling determines what you can and cannot do. So if you're like doing a play in an Orthodox theater, you've got like the lights, you've got like sound, you've got the stage, you've got the cast, you've got set design, you've got all those things, and they can help you to best tell the story. And things like plays, you get like such a long time. In South Africa, you get like maybe like, if you're lucky, you get 4 to 6 weeks to work a process, to rehearse it, etc. These award shows, Zala Mzansi, it's like even if you know that you're doing it well in advance, like the time, because of how much they cost, the time that you have to work on them is so limited. And those ones, it's very like, what's the next piece of the puzzle kind of work, you know? Whereas like the experiential journey of a play is more like character driven. And this kind of storytelling is more component driven. Like, now we're paying attention to this component and this component and this component. Mm-hmm. And it's up to you to come up with the arc that tells the whole award show. So for me, it feels like an award show feels like an event. It feels like you're putting together an event more than you are telling one story. So you have an event that touches on various stories. So like how you would arrive at an event and there's a photo booth and then there's a meal area, there's a rest place. That's how you kind of think about an award show. Okay, here's where we're going to do the formalities. Here's where, like, you know, it's red carpet. Okay, then we're going to go to our MCs. It's like you're going from link to link to link. And what you're trying to do is create a strong enough theme that can last across the entire show so that all the components are telling part of that one story. Whereas a play, you are really engaging at an emotional level with the audience the whole time. So you're trying to create the most emotionally involving arc. So for me, it always feels very logistic and pragmatic. Like, let's get everything in. Let's get it in the right time. And the other one has got a lot also to do with intuition, with pacing, with just feeling for it. Bana EP, yap.
Would you say, like hosting events like the LLL experience and like, you know, the game show, the live game shows, and do you think they help you when you come to such a space? Like,
absolutely, absolutely, because I have such a great empathy for the people that drive these shows because I have been in a capacity as a performer. Mm-hmm. So like if I'm writing a script for an MC, I know what it's like to MC and I know what the pitfalls of MCing are. Mm-hmm. If like someone is doing like a musical bit, I know what it's like to do a musical bit and I know what's very frustrating in that. So what I'm able to do from like my own personal experience is to troubleshoot problems that other people would have had. So I think that the reason I keep on returning to these award shows is because I'm able to pre-solve the problems that the performers are going to have. And if you solve the problems that performers have, you're always going to have amazing shows. Because when performers are confident, even if the show is if performers are confident, that thing is so palpable, like an audience is eat it up. And you can see like award shows where like the hosts are happy with the script, they're happy with the rhythm, they're happy with the flow. It just moves so nicely. And that's what I really try to get right more than the other technical components, making sure that the talent is always taken care of.
I guess that's the importance of actually hiring people that are talent themselves.
Exactly. Exactly, exactly.
So as the Standard Bank Young Artist of the Year for theatre, you are recognized not only for your artistry, but also for your commitment for developing opportunities for young artists just like myself. So how do you envision reshaping the arts landscape in South Africa, and what role do you think mentorship play in that?
You know, I used to do this project called 30 Days for the Kids. And like 30 Days for the Kids is like kind of like, it's like a vlog style series, very casual, where like I choose like, okay, if this is day one, for the next 30 days, I'm going to like share some learnings with the kids. You know? And then people used to like people used to come to me and say, yo man, you know, like we like this advice. We like, and I was saying to them, oh, I'm the kid. I'm the kid. Whenever I do like 30 Days for the Kids, I'm talking to myself. And like, when I say I've learned this, I'm archiving and documenting it for myself, because the only reason I managed to have like any inroads in the professional space is because of the variety of mentors that I still have to this day. So for me, like when people say, oh, you've mentored me or you've given me an opportunity, like I always like, I'm humbled by that. But I always feel like I'm just treating people the way I've been treated. And I think like there's a very big erasure of amagrootman nabo sister that we do when we like to become mavericks and go, ngahuzuka niwani and mina indlela ngihuzuke ngakhona akunamuntu ongisizile. Now I'm gonna put all of you on, but like how are you putting anyone on when you've never known how to do it, you know? So like I arrived like in Joburg like any other snot-nosed youth, and it's people who took me under their wing who made me realize, oh, I don't have to know it all, you know. I don't have to have the huge budget. I don't have to be able to afford the lab. If Majamela says, you know what, this kid is always making noise in my office, but like I'll give him space for a week or two and let me see what he does. And that was like my first professional work, right? As a student, people like Warunasiya and I go, okay, he's here as a student, I'm directing him in his show. But she took an interest in me beyond that and gave me advice about other things, what to read, what to look at, what to be more curious about for myself as a performer outside of the production I was working with her in, right? And like as my career progresses, those people introduced me to other people. I met Mandla Mbotwe, I met Fanny Swayisa, I met even my peers, like people who are my age mates, who helped me so much. So for me, when it's a conversation of, oh, you've given other people opportunities, I'm just like, I am just doing how, I'm just doing it how it's done. I'm doing the thing the way it's done. I've been taught how it's done, and I'm just repeating how it's done, believing that those people are also gonna subsequently do the same.
I believe in that. I believe in paying it forward. Yeah. Now I'm where I am because of people. Like I wouldn't even be anywhere near. I probably wouldn't even imagine that this position that I'm in exists without people. Mm. So yeah, I believe in paying it forward as well. You have received quite a lot of awards and nominations. How has this recognition influenced your approach to your craft, and what does it mean to you personally and professionally?
Anyone who says the awards don't matter is lying. you're lying. Like it's like, you know, those interviews of the rich people who go, it's not about the money.
Yeah.
I could say that because I have the awards. I could say awards don't matter. I could say don't do it for the awards, mm-hmm. because the awards don't matter as long as you're keeping true. They're lying. I want to tell you right now, they are lying. Awards matter, and they like, here I think what the core of what those people are trying to say is they shouldn't be the driving force behind what you do. Not having them does not illegitimize you as an artist. There are spaces that are probably only going to catch up to what you're doing many years later, so there might be some things that you feel you should be winning now that you probably won't, because like they are not in the zeitgeist of what they're currently awarding, you know? So in that landscape, yes, there are so many artists that are not awarded that I know, who I feel like are far better, you know, who are like, I look at it and I go, this person is deserving of these accolades. But like, really, they're not playing in the space that these accolades play to, you know? So for me, the awards are important because as a freelance artist, you can charge more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like just like as a tool for business, the awards matter because you can charge more. The awards come with prize money. Like that's always important as well. And they come with recognition for the work that you do. So like there's certain rooms that you begin to access when you're an alumni of a particular award. There's certain spaces that they allow you to go into. Mm-hmm. So you can think about awards and categories of that nature as tools, like as gateways, and they legitimize you to other people. Mm-hmm. You know, like they work in terms of abantu bathi, okay, let me look at who else has won this thing. Oh, it means they're in this conversation, you know? So they make you classmates with a certain group of people that you want to be with. So I don't think anyone should ever work for any award. I don't think anyone should ever feel like if they don't have an award, their work is not just. But raise your hand. Apply for them.
Yeah.
Like, you know, put your work in for consideration, because Ekobeleni, you're a professional and you want to be recognized in the professional space that you play. And those awards, like, even if it's a nomination, it says you are in that conversation, you know? Whether in Debe, we fumene okanye akhange uyifumane, what matters is that you are in that chat. You are considered with those people.
Okay. Wow. What motivated you to establish Etiwop and poetry overload, and what impacts do you hope that they will have on the poetry community? Also, it's just interesting, like, how did you come up with the elite wing of poetry? Like, obviously, it just takes it away from just anything and everything. It's like the elite wing.
Yeah, I think that speaks also to what I was saying earlier, but I've seen... We've played the 30 seconds, the Monopoly, what don't we have, you mm-hmm. know? Because, so I've been to so many open mics, I've been to so many slams, I've been to so many sharing sessions. I'm like, what do we not have? Okay, we don't have a thing where it's like, oh, shoo, shoo. Like, we don't have a thing where people go, yo, am I, you know? Because the spaces, for a variety of reasons, are very welcoming, very open to new people, and because those spaces are so limited, because like poetry spaces or literary spaces are so limited, they have to be that way, they have to be accommodating, so that the first time writer doesn't feel like they get spat out by the space the first time they arrive. So I was like, I actually don't wanna be counter this narrative. I carved my voice and my confidence in spaces like that, mm-hmm. you know, and if I had gone to a space like that and they spit me out immediately, I wouldn't have known what my journey as a poetry and performance person would have been like. But because now I've spent so many years doing it, and I feel like I'm at a certain level, I start feeling like, oh, there are other people who are at this level. What would happen if you have shows strictly for people at that level? Like, what would happen, like, if, like, you choose the best of the best now, and you're trying to find the finest, the best, the most professional, the most efficient? And that's how the elite wing came about, to go, look, if we could have, like, an imagining of the private school. Private school, yeah, my poet. Antwim, with people who you kind of go, they've been at it for a while, they know how to practice, they know their audience. And honestly, whenever, when we did that, when we came up with T-Walk, when we designed it, like, it was myself, my good friend Vusmus Pagati, and my good friend Rotabile Mutovi, like, we designed it, and we were like, we've hosted different kinds of slams. Mm-hmm. We've hosted like kind of charity event kind of vibes. We've hosted diary entry sessions and sharing sessions. Like, what if we make a thing that, like, it's competitive, it's compelling, it asks people, like, we take these characters, like, where the judges are strict and everything is, like, high level. Man, I tell you now, I feel like there's some posts that I watch now who've gone through that platform, and I go, this is why their level has never dropped. Like, you know, like, it gave them a template and a rule book and a way in which to approach poetry that has made them elite even to this day, to the point where they do their sets anyway. I see them warming up before, I see them prepping before, I see the weeks of work that go into one show. And usually that was a thing that came about because people knew that, yo, at T-Warp, if you are whack, disqualify a mad. And that was the point.
In your journey, you also touched on how you, like, love collaborating. What would you say is the importance of collaborations, since you've collaborated with, like, institutions, whether through residencies or with just individual creators as well?
I think, man, if you think of yourself as a subject matter expert on anything, you have to grant the same generosity to abanye abantwana. Bana, yo, lo mntu uyi expect kwenye ngayaziyo, nalona uyi expect kwenye into ngayaziyo. And if we enter every room and you lead with your ego, then you arrive going, I've spent the most years in this industry, I know the most, bow down to me. Whereas if you walk into a space and you go, whatever this person has lived through, they are the subject matter expert of their whole lived experience. That person is that, that person is that. So the wealth we have here, you then realize how, like, minuscule, like, your ego should be. Like, you realize, Bana, this person has lived a whole life and they've brought it to this room.
Mm-hmm.
This other person has lived a full experience and they've brought it to this room. So collaboration does that for us. It's a gateway to experiencing what people have experienced vicariously without you having to go through it.
Yeah.
You get to know the people's sensitivities, their strengths, their weaknesses, and they can contribute to projects so beautifully with all that they are. And that's what collaboration for me feels like. And like, it allows you to see things from a perspective that you might have never before. And you don't have to anymore because the person is here and they're generously saying, so beautiful.
You phrase it so beautifully as well. Because, like, everyone is a story. Everyone, like, whenever I meet people, I just know that there's so much that I can learn from this person. Yeah. But I also meet a lot of people that have, like, main character energy, of which is something that I struggled with also at some points. But then I had to realize, some experiences, because there's things I would never experience. But just, like, I get to know how that experience is like without actually going through it. And as someone who is deeply embedded in the South African art scene, what transformations or growth have you observed, and where do you see the industry heading?
Wonkumntu a content creator, wonkumntu influencer, and you know, as much as like the old heads like to like spit or punch down on that, I think that's actually good. I think like I'd much rather hundreds of terrible content creators than people who are not willing to go on expedition to figure out what their voice is. Like, I'd rather people fail, because while you are failing at that thing, you are learning so much about yourself. You're learning so much about what you want to say, about what you want to do. And the fact that people are taking such a leap to go, I'm gonna go grab this phone and this camera, and I'm gonna grab this mic, and I'm gonna go to the streets, or I'll ask people questions, or I'll do these pranks, or I'll... Then you're gonna get in trouble with security guards. Then you're gonna have people that swear at you. Then you're gonna ask 10 people, and out of 10 people, you only get 2 interviews. And then you get better at asking people, then you get 4 out of 10. Then you get better, you get 6. So you're learning something. Whether the content itself makes it is not the point. Whether the thing itself takes off is not the point. But what you're doing is you're equipping yourself with so many important and vital life skills. So for me, I feel like what has happened, a big change that I've noticed has happened that I really appreciate, is that the lack of uvalo. Abantu basanayo lando yobana yonza ulindele contract ya SABC.
Yeah.
Oh, yonza apply and until people are going, okay, I'll apply for this residency, I'll apply for this internship, but while I'm doing that, I've got my phone. I've got my own channel. I've got my this. And that for me feels like a shift in the last 5 to 10 years that has really been amazing. And it has spawned so much bad content. It has left the digital footprint of so much failure. But what it has also done is, for those who've been inspired, who are gonna make great content, they've seen that it's possible. So even if like the first 100 that are terrible, even if their job was just to inspire number 101 to make 101 who was going to be great, we needed those people. And we need people in different spaces who have the energy of taking a leap, who have the energy of going into a profession that was previously not known, you know. And so many people are not afraid now to tell their parents, man, I don't know how to explain this to you, but this is what I do. I place cameras over there and I cook. And then I sit in my room all day cutting me cooking. You might not see it now, but this is what I'm doing. And I love that so much, man. And like, for anyone who's making it, who's only getting one view, who's only getting one share, who's only getting one like, it don't matter. Because it's not necessarily the result. The result is going to come because you're putting in the work and the consistency. But the person you're becoming while making that, that's what's more crucial.
Thank you for like, your perspective is amazing. It's very beautiful. How you see things and how you like you kind of remove yourself. You don't say, I've been doing this for long, I'm good at this, and your guys are just whack. But you are seeing that actually in your trying, you are learning, then you can become great now in your own way. I think that's very important. So in understanding your creative input, output, sorry, 3 terms to stand out. Dope, wikichi, and sketching hard. Could you elaborate on those terms and how they encapsulate your creative philosophy?
The coolest way, hip-hop. I'm one of those kids like who really found the, like their footing and their voice and their language like in poetic meter and rhymes. And I identified very much like with... young men who found poetry as ways to express themselves, you know, which is what rhythm and poetry is. That's what rap is, you know, that's what hip hop is, like being in the know, you know, that's what you're being hip and you're the hop, you're with the movement, you know. So for me, that's like a thing that like really anchors me as a maker, because I feel like to write something, you must know something. You know, to know something, you must research something. And to research something means you must be particular about how it's done and process and making. And the only thing that you cared about when you were a young MC or a young writer was just being dope. That's what you care about. You just care about being dope. And there's an interesting thing like in American Ebonics or an American lexicon where like we all know that like nigger is derogatory, mm-hmm. and they took nigger, then they reappropriated it to for a term of endearment and affection,
mm-hmm.
and also know that like dope is one of those things, like when you get the purest dope, it's like a kind of drug, and that drug can get you arrested. But then those are the same kind of like economics that got people to buy houses, to move out of the hood, etc. So dope also became a thing that could be good. It gets you out, gives you like a little bit of like financial freedom. So like being dope lyrically meant that like that's the unit you could move. Like being dope with apparel, that's the kind of drug that you could move. Being dope with your ideas, that's the kind of thing that you could sell. So Oop Dope for me is about like in anything that you do, are you dope? Like in anything that you do, are you like really driving towards being the subject matter expert, you know? So for me, I always think about any collaboration as departments, you know? If you are in the department of acting, are you killing that scene to the best of your ability? If you are in the costume department, is this strip like really accurately representing this character, this me, this era, this feeling, this emotion? You at department of light, are you ensuring that like the stage that you've designed speaks to this moment, drives the emotional arc? So everyone, if everyone in the room is dope, then we all encapsulate Oop Dope.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then we're in the umbrella of dopeness. And that's and wackery for me then is like the complete opposite, right? To go, why are you trash? When there's so many examples around you of how great people are, you know? Like I'll hear so many young actors talk about, you know, I'm like reading Stanislavski, I'm reading Grotowski. I'm like, oh man, that's great. You know, you're doing like your Meisner technique. This is great. You are really accumulating a great deal of knowledge. And it's good that you went to schools that give you these other things. But like, who's the best storyteller in your hood? Like when was the last time you sat around people and like abaputibat? So you've seen technique, you've seen storytelling technique from when you were a pikinini. You've watched like Osisbako play Amakas, and you've heard how they build a world. You've sometimes been at home and a thing happens and you're there, and then a visitor comes and you watch your mother retell that story, and you're like, I was here, but now I'm hearing this person paint this picture for this other person. Oh, that's how story happens.
Mm-hmm.
I witnessed this, but I see how she emphasizes this or how she omits that. Or then you know that, oh, okay. So it's great that you know Stanislavski and all of them, but who are the storytellers in your family that have taught you how story is done? And if you are whack, you will not be woke to what's dope. And if you are whack, you're actually going to marginalize the great teachers that are around you, and you're only going to acclimatize to the ones that you got in your 2 or 3 year course.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not going to give credit to the people that raised you for 2 decades,
mm-hmm.
who are teaching you story, who are teaching you like empathy, you know? And for me, sketching is about once you are dope and once you know what's whack, you can then make skits around it. And that means that like you can put things on its head. You can make a Jay Barboza character who is a whack character, but you can make him dope. You can play whackness in an interesting way if you are doing sketches. Because sometimes what happens is like if you're super, super, super dope, uzawubhora, you know, because you care so much about the minute detail,
yeah.
that like you create a distance between yourself and the audience. And you realize the artists are a little bit more whack because they're doing it with their heart. They connect nicely with the audience. But the sketching sweet spot is people that are excellent and also understand banan sebandwin, you know. I don't have to bring my thesis up. So the thesis anchors me because I know it, and it's my responsibility to be like a driven artist and to know how to lead my audience. But once I'm with them, I'm not preaching to them. I'm with them. So the things that I do with my audience are in conversation so that I'm not pandering to them, but I'm also not letting them lead me astray. So I can still be in command, but then I can make them come closer to something that's nice.
Mm-hmm.
So the only way I can do that is if I blend in, if I look and feel like one of them, then they can have an emotional attachment to me. Once they have that, ngingabasondeza ke kwezinye izinto.
And I've witnessed you do that, like on stage, whether when hosting the game show or the first ever time I saw you in theater, it was at Kippies,
right?
You were Jay Bobos, and I was like, who's, like, it's like I didn't understand what was happening, because I'd only just watched one theater show, I think a few months before.
Okay.
I only had one theater experience, and then I saw this post on Instagram, and I was like, okay, let me go check it out, because I was still trying to, you know, get to understand the Joburg scene. And then when I get there, it's something totally different. It's like we are vibing, we are getting up, we are ripping, we are, it was, yeah, no, I experienced it, and I think it's beautiful.
Thank you.
I think it's amazing, and it's natural, because even during the game shows, like how you would make sure that everyone is engaging when we are playing something, like everyone gets up from their skits because they need you to hear what they're saying. It's just like it's amazing. Your involvement in productions like Ekaslani, and Ode to Kwaito, which you spoke about earlier, and Boom Bap, this is Sir Grab, showcases a fusion of different genres. What draws you to explore these intersections, and how do you navigate the complexities of blending different artistic forms?
Okay, that's interesting. Thank you. I grew up at a time where you could say to me, you could pick a time, like you say, maybe 6:30, or you say like 5:00. And then I could tell you, pick a day, say Tuesday or Thursday, whatever. And I could tell you across all the free-to-air channels what's playing. You know, like it's like, that's how I grew up as a consumer of content. I knew, but okay, Dragon Ball Z is at this time. Pokemon is at this time. Generations is at this time.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Gladiators are playing at this time. And the world I live in now, you couldn't ask a child what's playing when on what station, because people have their channels on their phone. So I haven't seen a TV guide.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that the selection of content has done is that it has made a multiplicity of genre consumption so easy.
Mm-hmm.
So when people are scrolling on their phone, whether it's Reels, Shorts, TikTok, you're going from music content to podcast content, then you're watching like a bit of anime, then you're watching sports highlights, like you're just sitting, like,
mm-hmm.
and then within an hour you've consumed so much in so many different languages, depending on what you're following and what your algorithm is.
Mm-hmm.
You're consuming anything from music to theater to live performance to sip and paints to events. And if you're making art in this era and you are not multifaceted in the genres that you're tapping into, I don't know what you're doing, because you clearly are not interested in the audience that you are dealing with. So for me, if I'm inviting people to a play, I'm inviting them to a play knowing that 1.5 hours of their time is a big ask. Because in 1.5 hours, yes, like the things they would have been consuming out there. So if I'm asking them to switch off their phone, at the very least, this show must be interesting musically. It must be interesting from a design perspective. It must be linguistically interesting. So if like they're coming to watch a thing about Kwaito, like the rhymes in the show must be nice. The characters must be great. The musical references. That's why Ekaslam has got a pianist. That's why we've got a keyboard as well. That's why we've got vocalists in the show. To make sure that like that simulated experience of like richness, you know, because you're competing with the phone. You're competing with the laptop. And it's not a bad competition, because content creators are good.
Yes.
Content creators are good. And if you are stuck to some novelty that people must pay attention to your show because it's the greatest thing. How? And why? You've asked me to leave home. And like the modern theater experience of Mzansi is a situation where, oh, I see a nice poster. I want to go to that show. I check on web tickets, whatever the platforms may be. That's about 150 minimum for a ticket. 200 if I'm going like on a premium night. 200, 250. And I want to go with my date. So like that's 250 by two. I live far from the venue, so that's petrol or Uber. So like that night is costing me about a grand two.
Mm.
And if like I'm in the foyer afterwards, I'm doing drinks, I'm doing supper. So that's like a grand 5, modestly, you know, if we're not going like, that night needs to be worth it. That night needs to be so worth it, because I'm getting dressed for that night. You know, like I'm getting so ready for that night. If I get there and I feel like I could have been at home.
Ish.
And if I was at home, my subscription to the streaming service that I pay only $200 for a month or $100 for a month, I could be watching the greatest movies from Hollywood. So why am I leaving my house if I'm going to come to you and you're not going to excite me with like variety and like an interesting things that are stimulating? So that's why we like to move our offerings from Kwaito to board games to clothes to hip hop, because we understand that we're dealing with an audience that's always dealing with those variety of things.
And so your extensive experience as a facilitator, lecturer and performer, and performance coach is evident in your diverse skill set. How do you balance these roles and what insights do you hope to impart into the next generation of artists?
So I think like I'm a little bit better at it now, but I think everybody, when they begin freelancing, it's always chaos. Like trying to balance a freelance schedule is not an easy thing. Mm-hmm. And I think because there are no freelancing masterclasses, each freelance journey, you're kind of learning your own do's and don'ts. You're carving your own mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
And while doing it, you get to realize, oh, these are my recurring gigs. Okay. So the recurring gigs are these ones. Oh, these are the gigs that usually happen at the top of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, these are the center of year gigs. These are the end of year gigs. Okay. So I can begin to build a calendar. I can start to say the important thing, like no. I can start saying no to projects of this nature if they don't fall in this time. No matter what I need, I just know that the top of the year, top of the year is always what I call plug-in gigs. So here, for instance, is a plug-in gig, because what do? I come, I plug myself in. I don't know what you do. I don't know where your script comes from. I don't know who brought this light. I don't know what's happening with the sound equipment. I don't know where this table. I plug in. And that's what I do for the top of the year. I accumulate a lot of plug-in gigs. What that does for me is like, it's good cash injection. It's good energy preservation, because I'm not starting like running hamster, right? And then I'm able to like pace myself for the year. This is when I start talking about my collaborations.
Mm-hmm.
This is when I start like blocking out, okay, in April, I'm going to put aside 3 weeks to do this. So, but I use that while I plug in.
Mm-hmm.
And while I'm plugging in, I know when those cameras go off, this is when I chat about the next thing. Mm-hmm. Oh, what's the other thing? Oh, okay. So now that I know what's in my second quarter, I spend the first quarter like plugging into other things that are going to help those things.
Mm-hmm.
Because by the time I'm doing those things, I'm going to need these connections that I was making deals with now to help me with that. And then once I've got like the archive of the first year, then the longer season work then can kick in. And then towards the end of the year, it's the corporates, the like year end functions, etc. That's like peak. That's when the clothes are selling like crazy. And then I know, okay, that's retail time.
Mm-hmm.
This is like cash in. And the reason we use like that October, November, December cash in period is so that January, February, March, we can really and plug in easily and move strategically. But this is like years of my work,
mm-hmm.
and it takes into account what I do.
Yes.
You know, you might find that like this method doesn't work for someone who's in the visual art space, doesn't work for other spheres and industries. And I think anyone who's freelancing, just really try to look at what your current recurring gigs are and what are the things that you have to do every month that like you cannot not do. And then figure out what like the more long-term works are that require a great deal of planning, and put those like a little bit further ahead in your year. And then try as much as you can to end your year with plug-in gigs, because what you don't want to do at the end of the year is you don't want to be doing too much heavy lifting, because bigger brands and bigger corporations are already doing that.
Mm-hmm.
They've got so much excess budget that all you need to do is plug in, get part of the budget, so that when you do your long things, you are a little bit doing it. You're doing them from a better cushion.
That's helpful to me even, because I'm still trying to figure it out. I'm still trying to figure out what works and stuff. And then sometimes it's kind of difficult. While we're still talking about what works and all of that, can you talk about being a freelancer and financial management and time management and discipline, like all of those things? How did you get to master them to be where you are?
Because
as a freelancer, like right now, January, you can get like a million, and then for the next 4 months, you don't get anything. So how do you make sure that 4 months from now, you are still able to like, you know, use this money to fund other projects or to eat or to pay rent or to do all of that?
So that's like the dance that like. So in my bio reads like artist, entrepreneur, teacher, right? Mm-hmm. And like, I always have to think in those three spheres all the time, all the time, because I go, if I'm a teacher, then I'm a good student. You know, like if I'm an entrepreneur, then like I'm a good customer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I'm an artist, then I'm a great consumer. So like, what do I like as a consumer that makes me look to art as an outlet? And what do I like as a consumer that makes me look at entrepreneurs that I really respect? And what do I like as a student that I keep learning from? So for me, all those things that I underlined beneath that make me like a learner from others. So these people that I was saying to you that like they've mentored me, they've taught me, mm-hmm. they're the same people who've plugged me onto investment opportunities, mm-hmm. they've plugged me onto how they plan their financial calendars, they've showed me how they register companies in interesting ways,
mm-hmm.
What kind of funding circles they go through. And for me, one of the most important things that I've always had in the business, especially for the last 2 to 3 years, is what is it that we are retailing on a daily basis? Right.
Mm.
So like for that, I even came up with the thing at Sinpower where we go, you know, people don't buy clothes every day, but every day people buy clothes.
Wow.
So okay. that for me goes, I know that it's not bread that we're selling.
Yes.
You know, it's not milk that we're selling, because people buy bread every day. People buy milk every day. People buy those things every day. So one of the big fears that we had with clothing is that, hey man, people don't buy clothes every day. But then I thought to myself, but every day people buy clothes. So if I can make every day someone choose us, then people are buying our clothes all the time. And I think one of the biggest things to do if you're in the freelance space is if you can have an easily monetizable product in any space that you do, because the moment you're an artist and the moment you're a good artist, you're automatically an influencer. Whether you are a purist or you don't want to hear that or not, if you're good at what you do, people are going to follow you.
Yes.
And if you attach a product to you being good at something, people are going to buy it. Because sometimes people don't know how to compliment you.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes they are willing to spend money to show that they can compliment you. So it's like, I don't know how to tell this guy that I really like his plays, but he just told me that he's selling the play.
So,
you know what? I'll show you. I'll give you my 250. You know what, man? You're so creative. I like your creative ideas. I don't know how to express that I like, but you've got this Dumelang thing. I want it. Let me show you that I'm willing to part with my money to like show my appreciation for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you have a product that you can sell every day, that's a very important thing that can sustain you. But like from a financial management point of view, man, like the same way, if you need a beat maker in creative space, you collaborate with a musician. The same way if you need like an instrumentalist, you'll go to someone who plays that instrument. Also, don't be shy to collaborate with people who are not in your sphere.
Mm-hmm.
Like find the financial professionals who are around you. Find the legal professionals who are around you and get their advice, because those people are experts at what they do the same way you are at what you do. So you can just sit with someone who's in the finance space, sit with someone who's in the legal space, go, look, man, yo, I've got this books. What do I do? I've got these dungarees. What do I do? I've got this money that comes in, but it's not as systematic as everyone else's. What do I do? How do I manage it? And those people, they manage so many portfolios.
Mm-hmm.
Like you are not an anomaly to them. They deal with people of your nature all the time. So get expert advice from other people.
And then the books that you've published, how's that? Like, how's the whole process? Like, especially like the first time you published a book, how is that? Because usually someone is going to wait for like, let me find an editor, then they're going to handle everything for me. I'll just send like the script. But like, you are more hands-on in the stuff that you do.
It's the best decision. Hands-on in book publishing, especially in SA, is the best decision. Guys, books make money.
Mm-hmm.
Books are good, and books can sell all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And books are not the kind of money that people have to wreck their brains thinking about. If someone likes it, they'll buy it. But I think the reason I got involved in the publishing process, I was led into it by Monaheng Mutsavi Uvice, and he runs this company called The Arts Konaheng.
Mm-hmm.
And like, he had this idea a couple of years back to go, his favorite plays that he's watched, like that black makers make, he can't read them. You know, so he did that thing that I was talking about earlier, like, how do you solve your problem? You know, like, instead of going, oh, we don't publish, he went, I'm gonna create a publishing house. And currently he's like just at like close to five, he's at five titles actually, he's about to increase his titles. So when I first published KKK, it was in collaboration with the Arts Gonna Feng, we co-published it.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about that is that like the cost to actually produce a book is very low. And it's tiny. It's tiny. Like the margins, they mustn't keep this secret from you. The margins in books, it's more than 800% of what you spend. And the costly thing is having a good book.
Okay.
That's
for real. Like it doesn't, I thought that it was expensive. I've had this idea and I've had like friends who also want to like self-publish, but it's like, I don't know where we got it, but we thought that self-publishing is even worse than actually finding someone to.
If you have your people and if you're not afraid of marketing your product, self-publishing is the way to go, because what it means is like you can also, once you've published, get signed on with the publisher later.
Mm-hmm.
Once you've proven your track record, you know, you can go to someone and go, look, we've sold 1,000 copies of this. Do you guys want to take it on and introduce it to more people? So like the thing about self-publishing is that it doesn't have to be the only way, but it's the surefire way of getting it started.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you are 100% guaranteed that at least you're going to have your first drop release. And the thing is that when you're printing books at volume, because you're doing them at volume and you're doing them at places that already do this, you can find that you are able to print maybe an A4 like paperback. You're able to end up doing it at 15 Rand or 20 Rand a book, right? So if you're doing it at 15 to 20 Rand a book and you're selling it at 250 Rand, that's more than, if you're selling it at 40 bucks, that's when it's 100% profit. But then you cross the 60 buck area, you cross the 80, you cross the 100, you cross the 120, you cross. And some books are going for as easily like 200, 300. And you might find that the person spent like 35 a unit, 30 a unit. The numbers are exponential. But the book has to be good. Yeah, bro? So the writing of the book or the generating the book, that's what the difficult part is. But if you've got all the content and everything is ready to actually produce it, to actually produce it is actually very, very cheap. And then you just put a crazy markup. The markup is crazy.
I think inking most of the times, like, okay, yeah, we can say it's opportunities, it's where you come from, and but I think it's lack of information.
Mm.
Like when you don't have the right information, you will not do stuff.
Yeah.
Even if it's, because I honestly did not know that it was like something that I can actually do, because I wouldn't even need to. If I'm paying 35 bucks, I don't have to like print out 50-100 books. I can start with 5 or 10.
That's
then
it.
With the profit from there, then wow, okay, thank you so much for that. Thank you. Are you currently working on something? Should we check out anything? How do we find you? How do we find your books?
Yeah, so I am currently like cooking some stuff for the new year. Very exciting things. Like we're looking at new designs at Sinpa.
Ooh.
Yeah, we're dropping some stuff for.
But it seems like it's always new designs. Like honestly, I'm like, okay, now I know. It's like something different.
And that's like what we're trying to do, is like create an interesting enough catalog, like where we've got some limited edition drops, where we release like maybe 50 of an item, like make some collectors. But like at Sinpa, we're dropping like some really interesting stuff for the Valentine's lovers seasons, you know, like some couple combos. So we've got some nice things coming up in that arena. We are re-releasing a couple of books. So second edition of KKK is coming out. And then we're gonna do like a new drop of a Kaslam and Poetotap, which I'm excited about for like middle of the year. And the other new stuff is like I said, you know, this is the plug-in era. So we're in the plug-in for the first quarter of the year. And then the new stuff, people can follow. I'm at JBobs Chabalala on Twitter, at Jefferson Chabalala on Instagram, Jefferson Chabalala on Facebook. And Sinpa and Updoop Shishini across all platforms. People can just check those out for the updates.
Okay, so like with the books, ne? Because I've like even the place of I asked this question, but I feel like maybe I didn't phrase it right. Like, how do you, because I was watching KKK, and the thing that kept on being on my mind was like, how did he come up with this thing? Like, how did he, it's so interesting. It's funny. It's thought-provoking. It's like, it makes you to think. It makes, like, it's how do you, how does that come? How do you?
Well, I mean, I think what, another misconception, particularly about people like myself, is because you see this thing I was telling you earlier about like the cheat code of like plugging in and mm-hmm. looking busy. You know, when you plug in, like you, when you look back at like the first quarter of your plug-in days, mm-hmm. you realize, oh, you've worked 6 days or you've worked 9 days. But in your social appearance, it looks like busy, you know. So the real jam is to buy yourself as much pockets of time as possible. Because the only way we can make KKK that funny, that insightful, that detailed, mm-hmm. is because there's time. So I would not lie to anyone and say like that was just like an overnight script, you know. It like, and it's years of work. By the time people watched it in this now 2023 version, mm-hmm. I remember that draft one of it was written in 2009, right? So it goes through editions, editing, different readings with different act. All the time, it's been directed before by Momo. I've mm-hmm. seen what that does. I've changed things. Mm-hmm. So like each time, and as you get better as a writer, as you get better as a reader, as you learn more things as a performer, you keep refining the thing. Mm-hmm. This version that we're about to release now, it's as old as what I've known last year. I updated it for the production last year. Mm-hmm. So you find that like the idea was strong enough to live for a long enough time, but it's also been, the idea has been patient enough to meet me when I'm more experienced. So now that I know better about how plays work, how they function, how characters work, how tonality mm-hmm. works, then I can apply everything that I keep learning. So I'm collaborating with my former self. I'm seeing, oh, okay, this is what this guy was able to do with his youth, and this is how I can play with it and change it.
In your role as a performance coach, you've worked with some of the country's finest comedy talent.
Mm.
How does coaching influence your perspective on comedy, and what do you find most rewarding about coaching others?
That's where the teacher part comes in. And that's where I am the biggest student, right? Because like I'm watching some of like I've been so lucky to work with some of the finest like comedy talents of this country, you know. And to plug into their careers and to see them grow as performers, as people even, you know. And I think what it does for me is like, I think because I'm a trained performer and they train performing, like it's so funny because I have classical training and Bona, they have performance hours, which is like a different kind of training. Mm-hmm. Like they make their jokes in front of people.
Mm-hmm.
And like you find a comic, it takes them 15 shows to distill a joke. And like they keep working their material. That's what they call it, you know. They work their material. They test the things with the crowd. And teaching performance to people who approach performance differently has made me change my perspective on what performance actually is.
Mm-hmm.
Because like when I'm dealing with like an act like Pop Pops, when I'm dealing with an act like Tsitsi Chumia, like they are they work in a medium that is direct to audience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I can hide behind the theater veil, and because KKK is an hour and 30 minutes, even if you are bored in the first 30 minutes, I still have time to win you.
Yes.
I can still bring you in. Like it can be confusing or whatever, but like over time I can warm you in. They work in a laugh now industry. Like they're in a like a shagango situation, mm-hmm. right? So their audience responds immediately.
Yes.
And they work in like short bursts. Comedians have as much as like 3 minutes sometimes on some stages. Like, but okay, there's an open spot, it's 5 minutes, and that's all they have.
Mm.
And what it takes for you to like capture a crowd in that time and relay a joke and be a performer while doing it and be confident, I've learned what that, like, I've learned things that I could have never learned in my classical training from working with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what it's done for me is, like, it's created such a good quality in me for hosting game shows as well. Because now I've learned how to work the crowd. Mm-hmm. I've learned from their skills how to, like, be direct with the audience, how to challenge, how to push back. Because they deal with hecklers. They deal with people who talk loud. They deal with people who are going to the bathroom in front of them and they've got to chirp them back. So I've learned so much about improvisation. I've learned so much about reading a room. I've learned so much about how you can adapt a joke instantly, right? Because the joke you were doing last night, based on what's here now, what's been happening with this person, I've learned a lot about that. Performance text can morph. And working with them has given me insight into how I can take that into my normal performance. Mm-hmm. Like, how do I take that into KKK? How do I take that into Boom Bap Swag Rap, into Eka Slam? And when I have done it, magic.
So I would like to ask you, what advice would you give, like, young artists or creatives that are navigating the complexities of this creative industry, or that are just like, I'm trying to be a full-time artist, I'm trying to do this thing full-time, but I don't know how, so I need to get a 9-to-5 or I need to do whatever, but this is what I'm passionate about and I would like to have more time to actually do it. And once I start doing it, I want to do it forever. I don't want to have to then go back to a 9-to-5.
Yo! That's tough, hey. That's so tough because I'm all there. That's where, like, I can gladly and freely say you're on your own. Because it's you. You know, the cliches are like, you miss 100 of the shots you don't take. You know, like, those are the we all know the quotes, you know, like, nothing ventured, nothing gained. So if you don't take the risk, unfortunately, you won't get the reward.
Mm-hmm.
And if you feel like you have a plan and you trust that plan, then go for it. You know, if you're going, okay, my 5-year plan is I'm going to do this job. It's going to earn me X amount. It means I can live in this area. It means I can buy these supplies. Mm-hmm. It means I can pay for these part-time classes. You know, if you have like a strategic, like analytical plan of that nature and you think you can see it through, you must also go, okay, this is the most positive way I can do it, and this is the most feasible way I can do it. And sometimes while you're doing that, someone else at like your periphery, who you're starting with, who dedicates their time only to that, is like getting opportunities, is soaring, is like, that's the gamble they took. And you know, and those are the rewards they take. But the other truth is someone else can do that and that can flop. You know, someone else can pour in hours into, I won't do a 9-to-5. I'll just do this alone. And that can lead to nothing, you know. And you can have your 5-year plan and whatever. I'll work. I'll stay here. I'll do it. And that can fail, you know. So you are that's why I get to like, you're on your own there. Like, this is like the game of zeal. This is the game of inkan. This is the game of like, I refuse to not win. Like, that's the only way you win. There's no guti. No, if I definitely start with 100K up front, I'm guaranteed.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's no, if I start with a grand, no. This one, and also because you are a freelancer, it's win to win to win to win. It's not like you win once and you are sorted. Mm-hmm. Like, you are moving from win to win to win to win. And usually it's win to loss to loss to loss to loss to part win to almost win to win nyana to win to loss to loss to loss. You know, so it's going to require kind of like tenacity, but inkani to go. If you're like, I'm doing this and I'm doing this for the rest of my life, this is the path I'm choosing. You're going to have to be a bulldog about it. You're going to have like an insatiable hunger to see it work. You have to be like maniacal about it. And me, sometimes people tell me, I remember even people telling me when I was much younger, like, yo man, don't you want to maybe get something a little bit safer, or you do this? And I'd say, you know, I want to tell you something. I hear you and I understand you. And I can tell that you love me. Because you don't want to see me fail.
Mm-hmm.
I could view it as you don't trust that it's going to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about you not trusting. It's about you wanting me actually to be safe at the end of the day. So I appreciate that you want me to be safe. But let me take this gamble. let me bet on myself and let me see how far it takes me. And if at the end of the road it doesn't work out, I have me to blame. Yes. Mm-hmm. And if at the end of the road it does work out, I have me to thank. And that's my journey. I can't hinge it on what it means to you. I can't hinge it on my parents. And that's why I say my advice to anyone who wants to pursue this, that's a conversation with you and you alone. And you know, and you have to make the decisions that you can face.
Mm-hmm.
Are you gonna be 56 and go, damn it? Or are you gonna be 56 and go, yep, yep, it failed, but I'm happy. Yep, it worked, but I'm happy. You know, like, yeah, no, there, it's just about gambling on yourself, man. There's no other way.
I think that's amazing advice. I think that's, yeah, no, I think that's amazing advice. Advice even I'm going to use. I'm definitely going. I've been applying in Ghana. Sometimes I didn't even know what I was doing, but I was just like, I'm going to do it and I'm going to figure it out later. And as you go, yeah, you figure it. Cool. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for coming. Thank you for honoring my invite.
Thank you.
It was, yeah, no, it was such an amazing and insightful episode. Thank you. Today we had the amazing and talented Mr. Jefferson Shabalala. Thank you so much for watching. Please tune in next week, Thursday, for another episode. We'll be posting last Thursday of the month until we can afford to shoot weekly. The podcast is available on YouTube. Please make sure that you subscribe, like, share, and comment. If you would like to advertise your product or brand, just email us. If you are working on a project and would like to find some collaborations or would like to be a part of our community, please do send us an email. The email is mamaforwork@gmail.com, which is mamma4work@gmail.com. This is Umama Wezizwe Sibiya, and I hope I am leaving you with a heart full of art.